thousands of civilians lost their lives in a single terrorist attack executed by terrorists belonging to Al-Qaeda, there has been a growing perception of a linkage between Islamic teachings and terrorism. Al-Qaeda, Al-Shabaab and Boko Haram are all names synonymous with terrorist activities, all in the name of Islam. Right-wing fundamentalism is also growing across Europe, and the British National Party, BNP, and the English Defence League, EDL, all blame what the term Islamism for the atrocities committed by Muslim extremists. Today on Hot Seat, we ask, has terrorism become synonymous with Islam? Welcome to Hot Seat with Akintayo. With a mainstream perception that a majority of terrorist activities around the world are attributed to Islamic fundamentalism, Muslims around the world have suffered abuse and persecution as they are often labeled terrorists. And Islam has, in some quarters of the media, become synonymous with terrorist organizations such as Al-Qaeda. Whilst it is accepted that not every Muslim is a terrorist, far-right organizations like the EDL and BNP blame the religion for some terrorist atrocities and accuse Islamists of trying to impose Islam on non-Muslims. When Norwegian far-right terrorist Anders Breivik killed 77 people in Oslo, he told a court in Norway that he deserved a Medal of Honor for combating Islamic colonization. Are campaigns such as the War on Terror a campaign against Islam? And why has Islam become synonymous with terrorism? To shed some light on this subject, I'm joined in the studio by Paul Salahuddin Armstrong, co-director of the Association of British Muslims, also a scholar and broadcaster. Carlos Cotiglia, press officer for the British National Party, BNP, a party better known for its anti-immigration policies. Abdullah Al-Andalusi, senior speaker, Muslim Debate Initiative. Also here, Tommy Robinson, co-founder and spokesperson for English Defence League, a far-right nationalist organization. And on the telephone, we have Raza Nadim, spokesman for Muslim Public Affairs Committee. Gentlemen, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, let me start with Paul. As a British Muslim, yeah, Paul, you must be frustrated with a blanket label put on Muslims as terrorists around the world.
Well, quite, because it's never mean that for me. I mean, I would never have embraced Islam over 12 years ago if it was because that's what I thought Islam was. And I know my Quran, I know what it says. I understand, you know, where it's coming from. So it's like, it's a very much misunderstood book. It is very much misunderstood religion. But by no means do these blanket labels really represent us at all.
Okay, let's look at your organization's mission. It seems the whole agenda of the EDL is against Islam. What is really wrong against Islam?
It's against Islamism, the spread of Islamism. We've been waiting for politically minded people to sit around tables and solve these problems. I'm just a working class lad from Luton Town, and we formed out of years of frustration and nothing changing. And from what we can see, there's more Islamic extremists in this country now than there's ever been. It's growing at a faster rate. It's got more funding from Saudi Arabia. It's going more 7th century. So we just formed to try and highlight, and basically when we go on the streets, it's like a cry for help for people to listen to how we're living. And wherever Islam is spreading in massive numbers, I'm not saying these two men I've spoke to this morning seem like great gentlemen. Some of the best people I've met through growing up in Luton Town are Muslim. But there is a problem in their ideology. There's a problem. It's not integrating. It's not working. It's not working in Britain, it's not working in Europe. Wherever we see it around the world, if we look to Nigeria, we see mass murder, we see Christians being blown up, we see Christians being blown up on Christmas Day, we see Sudan, we see Lebanon, we see Egypt, we see Pakistan.
Boko Haram in Nigeria, sorry to go, Boko Haram in Nigeria also blows up all
innocent Muslims.
But like your idea of Islamism, can you define it so that we'll really get where you're coming from?
7th century Islam, taking it back to 7th century, oppression against non-Muslims, a fascist ideology. But we see some people calling for reform, and we don't say that every Muslim is following, like he said, he knows his Quran, but the way he knows his Quran is going to be completely different to the way many other Muslims interpret the Quran. Many other Muslims interpret it, and when you say, is it synonymous, there's certain verses, whether it be 9-5, where obviously I'm not a scholar, but when it says things like, when the most sacred months has passed, slay the idolaters wherever you find them, and take them captive, besiege them, prepare for them in ambush, but if they repent, when you read that, that sounds synonymous with terrorism. You then start reading certain things and thinking, well, that's where it's coming from. And if it's not coming from Islam, then why are there 18,000 terrorist attacks since September 11th?
Okay, let's talk about the BNP. What is the stance of the BNP on terrorism and Islam?
Very few people used to talk about the differences between Islam and Christianity and Judaism. It was like nobody used to care about those subjects. People just went around doing whatever people do, not very much worrying about each other. But it's like 9/11 was a watershed.
Yeah, but what has anything got to do with that?
It has a lot to do, because basically, you mentioned the war on terror, and I do remember that the first person who mentioned the words war on terror was George Bush, and soon followed by Tony Blair. And suddenly we end up engaged in several wars in countries that were Muslim countries that were never a threat to Britain, like Afghanistan and Iraq.
So
suddenly the whole perception of ordinary people changed. It's like, say, this program is being broadcast to countries in Africa and the Middle East. And so, what we need to tell people in the Middle East, and we need to tell people in Afghanistan, and we need to tell people in Pakistan and Nigeria and many other places. The vast majority of the population in the Western world had nothing to do with legal wars, in the very same manner that the vast majority of the Muslim population across the world had nothing to do with 9/11.
Okay, let's
I think it's an issue of perception that is damaging us. All of us.
Okay, Abdullah, let's talk about, still talking about perceptions of Muslims as terrorists. When terrorists strike, the first thing they talk about is being divinely ordained to do that. Is it not a misinterpretation from the Islamic teachers to achieve their political gains?
Oh, not at all. If you look at Michael Schur, who's a former head of the Osama bin Laden unit, CIA, he says that the main and almost the most primary and overriding grievance is Western foreign policy. Of Osama bin Laden, Professor Bruce Lawrence of Duke University wrote a book on the statements of Osama bin Laden, and yet again, he said that Osama bin Laden's primary gripe and only gripe is really the foreign policy of the Western powers. And religion, like what religion does in any society, religion just underwrites whatever those values or perceptions or motivations of that society is. So if people want to launch a crusade, you can do it for money, wealth, power, and then just say, and God wills it, and you know, that's the underwriting it. But that's what religion does. Religion's always been hijacked for the purposes of various political factions. And I'll make a point. I am a follower of the quote-unquote 7th century Islam, which I don't, there's no different century Islam, there's only one Islam. And it doesn't tell me to go and force convert non-Muslims. I'm Portuguese in origin, the ancestry in Portugal, and as well, also Carlos is also Spanish in origin. We tell you that our history is Muslims, Christians, and Jews living side by side together in peace and harmony. And it wasn't no subjugation or humiliation. This is false. My organization has challenged the EDL to debate us on what Islam means. And his misquoting of text just now is, why don't you continue reading that text? It was talking about a specific historical situation where pagan Arab tribes were breaking their peace treaties with the Muslims, killing the Muslims, and the Quran said, right, for these tribes, slay their soldiers wherever you find them. And then it goes, for those who have remained true to their covenant, then maintain that covenant with them. And even then, for those who ask for safety, then escort them to a place of safety for pagan Arabs. So continue reading that Quran. Don't just give us soundbites, Tommy, because it's very misleading. You're misleading your own people.
Maybe you should have told that to the man who went on the murdering spree in France, who used exact quotes from the Quran to back up all of his murders on the videos. Once he showed the murder, he showed the quote from the Quran as to why he done it.
And Tommy, don't you think that
maybe you need to make sure people following your religion better.
No, but rather than, saying, he was saying...
Because if I read that, and I read it like that, then the man that went and killed loads of Jewish children and backed it up with quotes from the Quran, saying this is why I done it, and he actually specifically named why he done it, and the quotes, Surah 533, there's loads of them you can pick up, which basically say chop your hands off.
And I can also respond to that, and also look at Anders Breivik. Yeah, Anders Breivik, he wasn't a practicing Christian, right? He said it, but he used his Christianity to underwrite why he should have this holy war against Muslims, and that's what I'm saying, everyone needs their religion.
I want you to quickly talk about Anders Breivik.
Yep.
Just like Abdullah just said, Anders is not a Muslim. What if he was a Muslim? Your party would have raised something.
We say about terrorism, yeah? That's one man. I don't see Christians, Sikhs or Hindus blowing things up worldwide on a daily basis. You just don't see it.
But you talk
about Anders Breivik, and you've introduced us as far right, yeah? We're not far right. There's nothing far right about our organisation. We welcome everybody. We call everybody into our group. Anders Breivik, when he went on his killing spree, there was this big media campaign to link him with us. Yeah, that he was linked to us, and in order to demonise us as a movement, on page 1438 of his dossier, he describes us as naive fools. He says we believe the democratic process can solve these problems. He basically hated us. He explained why he hated us. He said that we have members of non-European and African background as leaders, and for this reason, he says our ideologies can never be reconciled. That's what he said. But yet there's this big media campaign to link us with him. The man was a monster.
He supported you guys, and he supported you.
Yeah, he did.
Let's not ignore the other text.
It's like in the early days of his two-year manifesto.
Don't forget, we have somebody on the telephone. We've got somebody, Raza, on the telephone. Raza. Hello, Raza.
Yes, hi there.
Raza, we've been talking about the text from the Quran. Do you think there is a correlation between terrorism and jihad that we saw in the Quran?
No, the only correlation that I've seen so far is the number of verses that Tommy Robinson reads, the more his idiocy increases. Because anyone can tell, as Brother Abdullah Andalusi very clearly stated, that when you look at it in context, it's very clear that Islam is not a religion of war. But here you have a complete idiot who keeps coming back and saying that Islam is the problem, Islam is the problem. If you want to talk about problem, talk about terrorism, let's talk about Anders Breivik, let's talk about those soldiers in Afghanistan that put quotes from the Bible on bullets when they're shooting children. Let's talk about the fact that George Bush said that he's ordained by God to go on the Iraq war. If you're talking about terrorism, we're the biggest victims of terrorism.
Raza has called for a jihad in Palestine, by the way.
Just like you support Israel killing Palestinians.
Calm down.
I'm not going to calm down because all you're doing is absolute rubbish, trying to come across like a reasonable person.
Well, maybe you need to explain that to your fellow Muslim brothers.
I'm not blaming anyone on Islam. Talking complete rubbish all the time. Raza.
I think Tommy has a valid question he wanted to ask you. He was saying it on the ground. Tommy, you wanted to ask a question.
I read that you called for a jihad against in Palestine.
Yeah. No, let's make it very clear what I said. I said Zionists are evil dogs.
Yeah, evil dogs. You called for a jihad against them, a holy war.
What you said was this. You said you support Israel's right to support itself, which means to support making a wall around Palestinian people, making checkpoints, and forcing Palestinian women to give birth at Israeli checkpoints.
That's what you said.
I said Zionists are dogs for doing that. There's a difference.
And you called for a jihad. So we have a moderate Muslim on the
radio who calls for jihad. Don't talk absolute rubbish. I said that every human being is within their right to defend themselves, and whatever cult you're referring to, you don't have a cult.
You're
saying random stuff.
Abdullah is about saying something, but then we'll get to Carlos. Right, Abdullah.
Firstly, jihad is a part of Islam, just like fighting for freedom is a part of liberalism or the Western culture. It doesn't mean holy war, it just means to fight for justice.
To you,
to Islamic scholars, to everyone who knows about it. Secondly, you said you don't hear about Hindus blowing themselves up. Well, then you have no knowledge then about the Tamil Tigers who have committed the most suicide bombings than any organization or religious group in history. Try reading outside of the Daily Mail. There's actually interesting facts out there.
No, it's not.
All right? And secondly...
Go on.
Yeah, and secondly, as I said, we can invoke a jihad or fighting for justice against legitimate resistance causes, especially the Palestinians who are being oppressed, who had their land usurped from them, and they have a legitimate right to defend themselves when people come into their courtyards and their towns with guns and shoot them.
Carlos was about saying something.
But I guess we are making an issue of one issue of many different issues. And when issues get mixed up, when we put too many things inside the pot and we don't know what we're talking about. I say, for example, you mentioned Mira. in France, and you mentioned Breivik in Norway. Norway. And I will say to you, I wrote about Breivik quite a few articles, and I said, somebody who goes out of his way with explosives and machine guns and suddenly breaks into a summer camp and kills a group of people that he has no knowledge of, he never met them before. I mean, we cannot make a political issue out of a pathological issue, because I guess no normal, rational, thinking person will just go into the streets with a machine gun and kill men, women, and children inside the summer camp.
In other words, we are
talking about individuals, and Mohamed Mira in France is an individual, and Anders Breivik in Norway is an individual, and trying to make the acts of individuals as representative of the rest of the world.
Okay,
when the media get crazy about it, and I think this is an opportunity to put things right.
Right. Yeah.
I say, the actions of individuals are the actions of individuals.
But they're not if they're doing it.
Because if somebody was farming in Afghanistan, and looking after his goats, like every day, and suddenly comes a flying fortress from the USA and starts throwing bombs around just because a group of people destroy the Twin Towers in New York. That is irrational. And I guess this is what the Muslims and the Jews and the Christians need to say.
Okay.
We ask our governments to stop being irrational.
Carlos, let's move to Paul. There's this question. There are so many religions in the world. Why is it that it's the Islam that is being targeted? And again, terrorists around the world always want to hold on to the platform of Islam as being the ordained platform for them to do this.
You know, I think Carlos makes some very good points, actually, because at the end of the day, a terrorist is a terrorist. Mm. There are certain political situations, geopolitical situations, that have occurred over the past, couple of decades. And it's these geopolitical situations which are often in Muslim countries, and this antagonizes, gets Muslims crazy that they're in those countries, because they often end up being victims of various wars and other conflicts that are happening in these regions. And then they get messed up. Now, if they were actually living in this country, then they would likely end up being recommended by their doctor to a psychiatrist. And they'd be seen by a psychiatrist. And the psychiatrist would be saying, these people are not of their own mind. I mean, how can you be of your own mind if you've had your whole family killed, you know, and you've seen your children butchered before your very eyes because of bombs that are being dropped on your house? You know, there's no justification for what they then go and do, but at the same time, they're not of their own mind. You know, and if a person is not in their own mind, you know, I mean, it's like, and Anders Breivik, I mean, the man's crazy. You know, no one can say that he's defending his country's interests by going out and doing what he's doing, or defending his people's interests. And in the same way, you can't say this for a Palestinian who's, you know, gone and blew up themselves, you know, it's an Israeli school bus or something, and killed a lot of, you know, Jewish school children that were themselves not, you know, responsible for his initial situation. These are irrational actions by people that are no longer in their own mind, and they don't know what to do. There's no justification for those actions, and I'm not justifying those actions.
This is because
of certain political situations and the certain hotspots that happen to be in the Muslim world, that there is a higher incidence of people that are now, you know, terrorists that happen to be Muslims or of Muslim backgrounds. You know, but if the reverse was the case and that was happening in Europe, then what you would find is there'd be a higher incidence of people of Christian backgrounds.
Okay, let's go back to the telephone. Raza, as the Muslim community equally ask itself, what is pushing some of Islam followers to indulge in terrorist activities?
Sir, could you repeat that, please? I didn't catch that.
As the Muslim community ask itself the question, what is pushing some of the Islam followers to indulge in terrorist activities and coming back to say they're doing it on behalf of Islam?
Well, see, I think that's a bit of a loaded question, my friend, because the thing is, what that's assuming is that there's something inherently about Islam and the Muslims which makes them want to act in a certain way which is not civilized. But the thing is, the truth is, that's not the case. And really, as Brother Abdullah pointed out, and as really the security services of the UK, our own country, has pointed out, that the main cause and the only reason for the issues that we see today, in which we see Muslims rising up and taking action, is because of foreign policy. For anyone to suggest otherwise means they may either have a malicious agenda or they are stupid. It is only one of those two reasons possible. Because what you will see is, as you've got from the Muslims on this show and the Muslims you're speaking every day, they are articulate, well-meaning people who only want to look after their families, earn some money, and then go in front of God and say, look, I tried my best to be a good human being. But then for a person to say that a maniac that acts as an individual and kills innocent people is somehow pushed by their faith, what they're trying to say is that Islam is an extremist religion, which is not true. Mm-hmm. And when you have certain guests on your show who use pseudo-intellectual language and say that, you know, if the people are following a seventh century interpretation of Islam, there's only one interpretation of Islam. Now, they're trying to use fancy language to say, basically, Islam has a problem, when Islam doesn't have a problem. Mm-hmm. We're the biggest victims of terrorism. And when you talk about terrorist acts and people talk about 9/11 and talk about how innocent people's lives are taken, on that same day on 9/11, 24,000 children died within the African continent. The war on terror should be done against those people that take food from the innocent people, that take the land of innocent people like the Palestinians. But instead, you focus on the people that fight back when they are the victims of terrorism. Muslims aren't terrorists. We're the biggest victims of terrorism.
People who fight back. He was talking about September 11th. So the people who fought back on September 11th were victims.
Well, hang on. I didn't say that they were fighting back. I said people in Palestine, when they fight back, they are labeled terrorists, but the Israelis aren't labeled terrorists when they clearly are.
There is an image. I agree, there is an image problem there. But it's like your party is sometimes labelled as a party of racist thugs, gangsters, and whatever. Don't you think that the same problem?
Even gangsters have standards.
The same problem Islam is having with that image of terrorism, your party's also have it.
It's nonsense, because we've blown no one up, we've killed no one, planted no bomb. We use our
democratic... Yeah, no, you've only punched a few people during demonstrations.
Do you want to let me talk, or do you want to carry on screaming erratically down the phone? Anyway, yeah, we've killed no one, we've attacked no one, we've blown up nothing, we've attacked no one, we've done nothing like that. We go on the street and we use our democratic right to peacefully protest. We're smeared racist. They call us racist. I hate racism. Islamism, Nazism, opposite sides of the same coin. Both fascist. Nazism's been eradicated, Islamism is flourishing like a wildfire across our country. Wherever we look in the world, that's what we see. We see bombs, we see murder. I'm from Luton Town. We had the fertiliser bomber, we had the 7/7 bombers get on, we had the Stockholm bomber, this is from one little town where I live, where I've grown up. We had another four. My auntie's next door neighbour last week was arrested for planning to blow up the Territorial Army. Four Muslims 3 weeks ago arrested for planning to plant more bombs. Now, it's not my fault. So then when we want to talk about these issues and we're angered by them, you talk about grooming. The grooming and systematic rape.
Oh, God, let's talk about the grooming.
There's no 12-year-old Muslim girls getting raped by 20 Muslim,
oh,
20
no,
Christian men
grooming,
in this country.
That's a lie, what
let
you
me
just
talk
said.
About it, because I'm talking.
I'll get to you very soon. No, let him finish.
There's Christian girls, right, not just Christian, non-Muslim, basic girls, being raped and pimped across the country, right, and we talk about grooming, and then we talk about the reasons why, and people, again, we look and we see it linked to Islam. And the reason why we see it linked to Islam, because when we ask, if I can ask one of the Muslims, how old was the Prophet Muhammad when he had sexual intercourse?
Here we go, and you're going to come back on, even though
let's
have Abdullah respond to that, please.
How old was the Prophet? Just simple, how old was the Prophet?
Are you going to let me respond?
Yeah.
Are you going to suppress my freedom of speech?
Abdullah.
No, go on.
All right, then.
It's Razza, shout.
Right. Well, now, basically, what we're seeing is some guys in Rochdale used alcohol and they committed fornication with some white women, and we see this, right? Mm. Is alcohol and fornication allowed in Islam? Mm. No, it's forbidden. I challenge you to find me any verse of the Quran or hadith or anything, yeah, that says that drinking alcohol and sex outside of marriage is allowed in Islam. It is not, sir. So I think you'll find that you're trying to now label these guys who are now adopting a culture which you'd probably be more familiar with than we would, all right? It's not Islamic culture. Secondly, if you look, the CIA World Factbook.
Answer the question.
Let me finish, right? The CIA World Factbook, yeah? In the space of from 1980 to 2005, Yeah, only 6% of terrorist attacks in America has been from Muslims. They were actually beaten by Zionist extremists, so we've got 7%. You've got extreme left-wing groups, 24%, communists, 5%, Latino, 42%. So, and again in Europe as well, the vast majority of the terrorist attacks were the Baath separatists and other and far-right groups. Before I answer your question, I want to make another point. You know, Al-Qaeda is kind of like, has the same problem as the EDL. You see, the central Al-Qaeda don't control everyone who's part of who says, I'm Al-Qaeda, right? And you see Osama bin Laden writing letters telling people, don't do this, you know, don't do this in our name, yeah, in Iraq or whatever, right? Yeah, at the same time, the EDL, some of their guys can go, they can bottle women wearing hijabs.
They can burn mosques, they can shout EDL, they can graffiti it.
But because EDL don't have an official members list, they can always publicly disassociate themselves. This allows them to have their cake and eat it, right?
Abdullah, answer my question.
I want to answer.
Yeah, you haven't answered.
Right? Did the Prophet Muhammad SAW get married to a woman who was post-pubescent? Yes. She was post-pubescent at a young age? Yes. But the average life expectancy of that time was 35.
Did he have sex with her when she was nine? Did he have sex with her when she was nine?
Look, you're making judgments.
You're not answering the question.
It's based on one hadith, and that hadith is contradicted by the same person who actually narrated that.
How old was she?
Okay.
Simple question, lads. How old was she when Muhammad?
It could be 9 or 19. The difference of opinion. 19 and 9. But she was.
No, agreed.
Let's hear from Raza. Raza, maybe you could answer that question. Raza.
There's a couple of points, because I'm going to come back to a point they mentioned earlier about how there seems to be some grooming issue within the Pakistani Muslim community. And the thing is that I've mentioned this before, and again, it's a case of facts are not being looked at. A simple freedom of information request into the West Yorkshire Police will saw in 57 cases where there were gangs of people grooming innocent young girls. 5 of them were Asian, 47 of them were Northern European men.
I said that gangs of people,
they found in 47 cases, it was men, it was Northern European freedom information request into the West Yorkshire Police. Not my words, theirs, you can check with them.
Let's get Raza, thank you. We'll have to take a break in a moment. When we come back, we'll be looking at more issues concerning Islam and terrorism. So let's go on a commercial break. We'll see you in a moment.
You're watching Vox Africa. Sofia, we're on our own.
Does that mean?
Listerine sauce coats the pasta all over.
Perfect partners, just like us.
It's a night like this.
After food like this.
With nobody home.
Oh, Carl.
We're home.
Dormios dirty.
When's your Dormio day?
For 50 years, Tolly Boy has selected the finest quality grains, and generations trust us to deliver delicious rice for their family. Our easy cook rice promises to always deliver great tasting results for every meal. Great food starts with Tolly Boy. And look out for special 10% extra free promotional packs in selected stores now.
I'm going to surprise someone.
I have been authorized by the board to take you, all of you, to Abuja.
Abuja.
This is Flamingo Airlines Flight 212. We have an emergency.
Yeah.
Jota. Change your style when you come down from Vega. Where you getting close to a Jota? Open your eyes to wear your sensor for my butter.
You're watching Vox Africa.
Welcome back. You're still on Hot Seat with Akintayo, and we are asking, as terrorism becomes synonymous with Islam, what do you think? Send us your comments on Twitter at HotSeat_Vox. Email us HotSeat@VoxAfrica.com and join us on Facebook.com/HotSeat on Vox. Before we took the break, it was getting really, really hot. And let's quickly get back to Raza on the telephone. Raza. Hello, yeah. Raza. Yeah, Raza, Tommy made some points here, and for people who don't really understand the religion of Islam, people had always been worried that the underpants bomber claimed to be a Muslim who went to Yemen and was brainwashed, according to him. And a lot of people, talking about the Rochdale event, they always ascribe them to be Muslims. And also the Shafilia event, the Shafilia murder case going on in the UK, where the father and mother killed this girl because they felt she was too westernized. Don't you think it's something that is giving people who don't really understand religion the right to talk that way?
Look, I understand that there are some people who do some crazy actions and they happen to be Muslim, just as you get people who take crazy actions who happen to be Christian or Jews or Hindus or of no faith whatsoever. But the thing is that the problem is this, that there is no real debate or dialogue taking place, because what you often find is many right-wing papers, and you find people from certain groups that use certain language, inflammatory language, who aren't looking to have a dialogue, but under the ruse and under the pretend veil of having a dialogue, what they do is that they attack the religion. So what you had earlier on was that you had Tommy Robinson from the English Defence League saying that what he was implying was this, that from a narration of the Prophet's peace be upon him, where he had heard that the Prophet married a girl who was 9, although shown by Abdullah, then in some cases people say it was 19, so there is some discrepancy regarding that. What he's actually trying to imply, though, is this, that the Prophet was essentially a paedophile, and that because your Prophet was a paedophile, you guys can be too. That's what he's trying to imply. Actually, that's not a dialogue. Yeah. That's not a dialogue at all.
Let Raza finish there. Yeah, go on, Raza.
Yeah, that's not having a dialogue whatsoever. What that's doing is throwing out rhetoric out there to get a reaction from people. And instead of having a proper dialogue, which needs to be had, and I agree with that, a proper dialogue, that's not had. Instead, what you have is people like myself and Tommy Robinson on there, basically people just shouting at each other, saying, no, you're wrong, no, you're wrong. Because okay. The fact is this,
right now
is not a place to have a dialogue. Instead, okay. Right now, what we find is just rhetoric. Because as I've shown you right now, it's mainly white people who are involved in grooming cases. Police show that 97% of the cases are white people who are on their register. So why don't we talk about that? But no, let's instead talk about those people who are Muslims instead. So what that means is there's no real place for a dialogue, because if you want to have a proper dialogue, what we'd say is that, hang on, there's a problem everywhere. Let's talk about all those problems. No. But instead, you find people focusing on the Muslim problems, because right now, with the flavor of the month to focus on, and guess what? We've proven them wrong in the past. We'll prove them wrong again. Mm. Muslims are not terrorists. We're the biggest victims of terrorism.
Okay, Tommy,
When he said about saying about Mohammed was a paedophile, under current British law, yeah, that would be correct. But yeah, well, I don't blame Mohammed.
No one is sure of the age, whether it was 9 or 19.
When you've got a large percentage of Muslims who follow, Sahih in Arabic means authentic, Sahih Bukhari, Sahih Muslim, both Hadith state she was 9 years old when he had sex with her.
Now, excuse me,
I'll just let you finish. Can you please let me talk?
Let him talk.
Okay, sorry. You've got 47 girls in Rochdale, yeah? You've got 60 girls in Telford, you've got 30 girls in Derby, you've got 100 girls in Blackpool, you've got another 50 girls, there's another court case at the end of this month. These figures are an epidemic. You've got 80%.
Great, I want to come back on this.
Just, Raza, please be quiet.
Go on.
You've got, with arrest rate, you've got 80% of child grooming gangs convictions are Muslim. 80%. 3% of this country is Muslim. Now, that is massively overrepresented. So you have to ask yourself, why? Why is this going on? Why in Rochdale did the ex-local mayor, who's a Muslim, and a current Labour councillor, who is also a Muslim, go to the court case and stand up and defend 9 paedophiles who have raped and systematically abused our youth in that town? And when they've been convicted, why is there not public outrage by the Muslim community for him to be removed from his position of power? Why is there never any public outrage? Why, if you reverse the roles and Muslim children were being passed around Christian businesses to be sexually exploited, there would be massive public outrage by the Islamic community.
Sure. They would be out on the streets. Abdullah should be able to
say the whole country would be on fire.
Firstly, if you check the newspapers,
we'll get to you
especially
later.
Some of the populist ones, which you probably read a lot. lot. He only knows about this because he's read in the newspapers. There has been an outrage about this.
There
has been an outrage about this. Mainly Phillips has talked about it. Ben Aronovich is talking about it. It's gone everywhere, all right? Yeah. Secondly, when you mention about these girls being plied with alcohol and seduced.
Whose families do you think
this
they are?
Firstly, this happens a lot amongst general society in the street, street gangs and things. There was also the news, the police talking about these problems. Alcohol being used, and which is not Islamic. Sex outside marriage, which is not Islamic.
These men were...
Again, you're talking about these men were whatever, but they're not following Islam. They're not following Islam, though. And secondly, also, he talks about paedophilia, okay? He talks about paedophilia a lot. And why would he talk about paedophilia? Paedophilia is defined as sex with prepubescent girls, so girls who have not reached puberty. Okay, so that doesn't apply to the Prophet Muhammad at all.
Let me finish.
The Prophet Muhammad did not have sex with any prepubescent girl without, and he did not have sex with a girl without her consent.
Sex with a 9-year-old
outside of marriage. It was within marriage. It was with consent. It was no coercion, and it was after she became a woman, as defined by the standards of biology. Yeah. And lastly, if we want to talk about paedophilia, let's go there. Richard Price, in your organisation, you can always deny. Yeah. See, they always can deny them when they get caught. You see, that's the thing about EDL. Also, whether they found child pornography on his computer. When you want to look for paedophiles, try go looking in your home. Don't go looking. Don't go pointing all the finger. And secondly, according to British law, the husband of Mary, Mary, the mother of Jesus, he'd be done for paedophilia too, because Mary was roughly about 12 years old when she got married to Joseph Arimathea. So, are you going to condemn the husband of Mary, mother of Jesus?
Will you condemn him? Anybody?
Okay,
a 12-year-old. But can I ask?
Do you condemn the husband of Mary, mother of Jesus? Are you Christian? Do you support Christian values?
A Muslim's goal in modern Britain is to emulate the Prophet Muhammad. Yeah, that's not every single Christian's to emulate exactly what he done. Yeah. Now, when you're emulating a man that had sex with a child, which we've established he did, but when
we haven't established. Paedophilia is prepubescent.
This is the problem.
Learn definition.
This is the problem.
Let's forget about paedophilia issue.
The Islamic community's definition, this is where we have the problem. Yeah. They don't see having sex with a 10-year-old who started puberty as paedophilia, as my man has confirmed. She's 11,
that's
if she's 12. No, that's your definition. That's what
it's
you
the World Health Organization's definition of
you've
paedophilia is sex with
you've
a prepubescent.
Okay.
The World
Health
Organization.
Let's forget about
it. The World Health Organization defines paedophilia.
Let's forget about
paedophilia.
Let's forget about that now. Let's talk about. Let's quickly get to Paul. Paul, before the dawn of terrorism, Islam has always been seen as a religion of peace. And even non-Muslims are always looking forward to going on the holy pilgrimage to Mecca and Medina. What has really changed over the years?
Just media hyping things up, isn't it? And jumping on cases, as Carlos says, about individuals. Mm. And they're not representative of Islam as a whole. And, when you get people like here, Tommy Robinson, and he's bringing up about, an incident in the life of the Prophet, peace be upon him, which he doesn't even understand.
I'm trying to understand why Muslim men
I was trying to explain it to you, and you weren't listening.
You don't understand
the intricacies of Islamic scholarship. You don't realise there's different reports about the age of Aisha, and every other report that references her age contradicts this report about her being 9 years old. So it means that it was also taken from him when he was an old man. The person who narrated it was an old man at the time, so he probably wasn't quite right in his mind.
A lot of Salafi,
or somebody might have misheard him. Maybe they do believe that, but at the end of the day, this is not a mainstream understanding of Islam.
Let's try to learn from
that he believes that, but what I'm saying is there's big percentages of Muslims that don't, and they follow the fact that it's okay to have sex with anyone who starts puberty, and that's not okay.
This is not something Islamic scholars agreeing with.
But I just heard one thing. That Muslims that do things that are not according to the rules of the Quran. And I say to you, the issue is that we are mixing geopolitics with sociological things that can happen in any country, because we do know, for example, the conditions of deprivation, poverty, drug abuse, alcohol abuse, and all that sort of stuff, and that is going on in the UK. UK is a society in free fall. It happened before the recession and it's happening now even more. And the issue that you mentioned about the immigration, and why I think immigration is such an important subject, is because immigration in this country mostly is of a financial nature. If people come to this country because of horrible conditions in their countries where they come from, and they suddenly land in the UK, but they land trying to meet their financial needs, but there's no real cultural integration, which means they grow up in ghettos and they develop mentalities of ghettos that have little to do with geopolitics, have more to do with the mentality of the ghetto. It happened before between the black communities and the white communities in the UK that they saw each other with suspicion. And that's why you have 470 armed gangs around London and all the rest of the stuff.
Going back to the issue of Islam,
I say, because of the political context in which we are, two major wars in Islamic countries, several incidents internationally, but suddenly we put together international issues and geopolitical issues, and we mix them up with what can be very personal, individual situations. And I say, and that's why we get into a muddle, because we suddenly talk about Iraq, Afghanistan, the Quran, what happened with deprived societies in Northern England, and they all seem to be part of the same subject, and they are not. Because we need to make the difference. We need to tell the difference between things. And what happened in Egypt or Somalia or Nigeria, those are very punctual realities. The confrontation in Iraq between Sunnis and Shia is a very Iraqi issue. Okay. And the situation in Palestine is a very Palestinian issue. And what happened in Northern England is a very Northern England issue.
And the point is,
we have to look at the issues on themselves without trying to find connections, like international connections, that do not exist. Because if you go to Egypt, or if you go to Libya, or if you go to whichever country, Somalia, people are very much in touch with their daily realities, everyday realities. They don't do things in Somalia because of something that happened in Rochdale. It's like saying, we need to look at the issues where they happen and look at the people who take part in engaging those activities, where they happen.
What do you think the reason is then?
If you look at those rape gangs, right? Did they say, we did this in the name of Islam? They didn't say that. They drink alcohol and they have sex outside marriage, which is antithetical to Islam.
This reminds me of what
Bruce Lawrence said, as a professor who monitored all and investigated all the statements of Osama bin Laden and compiled a book called Messages to the World, the Statements of Osama bin Laden. And in one of this, he had a journalist having a conversation with Osama bin Laden. And a journalist said, but we hear in the hadiths, the narration of the Prophet Muhammad SAW, that you can't kill women and children. So, and also in the Quran. So how do you reconcile this? And he said, and Osama bin Laden said, well, that's not set in stone, you know. In this context we live in, we have to fight them as they fight us. Yeah. So they kill our children, we kill their children, their whatever, right? So Osama bin Laden is a modernist. He's a reinterpreter of Islam. He's not a traditional Islamic Muslim, yeah. Because he by his own admission, he said the rules are not set in stone, and you can change them.
Okay,
I don't believe that.
Let me quickly ask. Let's go back to the telephone before I ask Tommy a question. Raza.
Yes.
Yeah, there is this issue about people trying to use Islam as their platform. They do bad things. Well, like Baroness Wasi said recently, that it's like what happened with the grooming of white girls, that a lot of people don't want to talk, especially Islamic scholars who are supposed to talk against this thing. Now, this is one of the problems people like Tommy are having. Don't you think that you should come out more?
The thing is this, look, this is what I find interesting.
First of all, I want to go back to a point that Tommy had mentioned earlier, which is the case of that white girls are being targeted. What's come out in the reports that there were also girls from a Bangladeshi origin, girls from other origins too that were targeted. So to come out and say that it's just after white girls, what that does is that it actually, it creates smoke and mirrors. What you're doing is that the thing is what you're taking away from the fact is that they went after and they targeted any vulnerable girls they could. And these men were vile degenerates. And they should be treated as such, and then they should be punished with the harshest hand of the law. However, one thing to be made very clear is this, that we have to keep, when people like Tommy Robinson say that, you know, Muslims have got to come out more to condemn this, we've seen very clearly on this show as well, you've got people, leaders in the Muslim community, very articulate people like Brother Abdullah, Brother Paul, coming out and saying very clearly that this isn't part of our religion. So when you say we've got to keep condemning it, why? Because the thing is, it's very clear already from the beginning that we're against it. When this happens, we're saying we're against it. When you say Muslims got to come out and speak out against it, what you're implying is that's only a Muslim issue. When clearly, as Brother Abdullah pointed out with the fact, the issue within the white community, etc. But we're never going around saying white people sort out your problems. But it's only with the Muslims we're saying sort out your problems. If we're having a genuine discussion, you have to look at the fact that really majority of these cases, you find that there are people who have a sick problem who are mainly white. Until we talk about it, honestly, as a Muslim, I can't take Tommy Robinson seriously, because I think if you want to have a serious discussion, you'd realize that, hang on, the biggest problems within your own community, not ours.
Look at the media. Look at the media, right? When a person commits a crime and he's Asian or Pakistani, whatever, they say Muslim did this, Muslim did that.
They say Asian.
If a Christian did it or whatever, and even look at how they report Anders Breivik, yeah? If a Muslim did it, instant terrorist, no one would say, is he insane or not? No one would say that. They say, put him straight to jail they're fit for court and arrest or whatever, right? And they've done this. But when Anders Breivik did it, oh, maybe he's insane. Maybe there's something wrong with it. Oh, no. Surely no one who's white and far right would do that.
Never.
There's double
mentality.
Standards, you see. Now, as I said, and you pointed this out yourself, that when the such newspapers like the Daily Mail and Daily Star, the same newspaper that demonized Muslim are also the same newspapers that would demonize some far right groups, which I thought you guys would have known by now, that newspapers are sensationalist. What sells newspapers is to see something that makes you angry. That's what sells newspapers. So you did your research on Muslims from these same newspapers, misrepresent you, Tommy.
Can I come back and say something, please?
Yeah, quickly, just make it very brief.
Yeah, sure, very quickly. I think that you asked a question earlier about saying that, you know, before the dawn of terror, we had seen that Muslims, you know, were basically nice, peaceful people. But the thing is that what that assumes is that terrorism began at a certain date. If you were to ask people within the African continent or people within the eastern part of the world, what they'll tell you is that there were certain people who were white Christians who came along and used their religion in a false way and created an empire and stole people's resources. So really, the dawn of terror happened ages ago. The thing is, when you talk about terrorism, really, when you start looking at terrorism, you realize that all of these issues are linked to political cases, and this animosity that you see of Muslims or people from other backgrounds is because of the actions of Western countries in the past and the foreign policy right now. Now, I'm not trying to say in any way, shape, or form that it's right to go around and start killing people, you know, on a wanton basis. But the thing is, if you want to have a serious discussion about people, why people are terrorists and why people take such extreme actions, you have to look at the root cause of it.
Okay. Carlos has something to quickly say.
The one issue we need to talk about, and this is important to talk about, because you say Western countries, and I have an issue with that. Before the invasion of Iraq, I marched in Hyde Park with a million others, protesting against the invasion, the planned invasion of Iraq. We made a point of being there and say this is not our war. Iraq didn't attack Britain. We have no right to invade Iraq. And there were hundreds of thousands, millions of people in the Western world who are against the war in Iraq.
Exactly.
And I say the point that I want to make to you is, in one side of the world, you have governments that do things that their peoples do not support. In our side of the world, we have governments that do things that we people do not support. And the issue is the need for dialogue, the need for the world, for the Arab world to know a bit more about the Western world, to know that we are having, in many cases, the same problems that the Arab world had for ages, which is to have rulers that did whatever they wanted without paying attention to the people. And here in UK, and Raza, we need to agree on this, we just had an election in which only 38% of the people in London actually voted. Mm. And we call it democracy. And the media, the mass media in this country have nothing to do with democracy.
Okay, we're running out of time. Let's quickly, there are some very important questions.
Let's get back to the central point of this show, right? Yeah. Is Islam synonymous with terrorism, right? Mm. Now, Tommy Robinson goes on a lot of shows and platforms, and he likes to quote verses. And of course, he quotes it, and then he thinks he's
quite
won
the
argument.
Here's the thing. We don't have time.
Last year, my organization challenged you to an affair in public platform. We're going to go through all these verses
that you like to quote, and you said
thanks, but no thanks on your Facebook group. So I'm challenging you
on Facebook.
On your Facebook group.
On
yeah,
Facebook. Yeah.
So because you wouldn't respond to our emails. You would not respond to our emails.
Never spoke to him in life.
We sent emails. We sent multiple emails to your organization to say we were. Range in an open public debate, a fair debate. We had a history of fair public debate.
Do you wish to challenge us to that?
Yeah. Right?
Do you accept it?
All right, we'll organize it then.
Let me quickly challenge Tommy.
On Facebook.
Tommy, let me challenge you on something. For me, I just believe that maybe you're not ready to learn more about some things that you don't know about them because about Islam.
I learn by what I see.
Why I'm saying this is like even in Nigeria with the Boko Haram thing, when it started, a lot of Christians thought Boko Haram was against them because Boko Haram means Western education is prohibited. Mm. And they use the telephone, they use everything, hypocrisy. But the thing is that now they are killing Muslims. They're killing anything that they feel that is against them, Muslim, Christian. Would you call those people real Muslims, even when they're killing the Muslims in their midst? And apart from that, there are also other issues that are surrounding.
They're killing in the name of Islam, right?
They're claiming to be killing in the name of Islam, and they're killing Muslims.
I know. Yeah.
And even in Iraq,
they believe them to be Muslim, killing
the other people.
I know.
Why would they want to be proper Muslims?
There's so many wars within Islam.
Yeah, but yeah, Tommy, why don't you want to understand Islam itself before you
look at the Middle East?
There's so many different interpretations of Islam. I understand Sufis are great. There's some great sects of Islam, but what we see now being pushed through this country is Wahhabi, Salafi, Saudi-funded money. You're not allowed a Bible in Saudi Arabia. You're not allowed to drive on the same road, side of the road as Muslims to Mecca. Women are not allowed to drive. It's a completely fascist country, yet they are now dictating what form of Islam is being pushed through the mosques and madrasas in this country.
But you're dictating to Muslims. You're dictating to Muslims what culture we have to follow and how we should integrate.
Follow
to be
your religion
to
however
you
want, but what we see, I live in Luton Town, we see hostility, we see violence, we see terrorism. It's what we see.
Is that a Friday night? A typical Friday night for you, Tommy?
We lost
one. Go down the pubs on a Friday night. You'll see violence. You'll see hostility. You'll see arguments. You'll see that kind of stuff. Because as Muslims, we stay away from that. There will be reduced hostility.
We don't promote that kind of violence.
Something that you miss is the difference between Muslims who are actually living up to the principles of Islam and Islam is really informing their lives and between people who just have Muslim names or, you know, other people will refer to them as Muslims. Yet if you ask them, they'd say, well, I don't really follow, I'm not that religious or something like that. And there's a huge difference, just like with Christians. Well, you know, people who go to church on Sunday, people who actually give a lot of charity and are informed by Christianity, and people that, you know, they just have a Christian name.
Okay, Tom, let me quickly ask Abdullah a question.
Muslims come from foreign countries to this country. And I observe that there are so many Muslims that are together in like places like Leicester, Luton. But the thing is that they see their host as people who are not doing the right thing. Is it not disturbing that some Muslims still feel like even white, just like what happened with the white girls, feeling that the people are too westernized or they're not following the codes? That is it not wrong for them to come into somebody's land and still want to force their culture or their religion on them?
Okay, well, firstly, me and Paul are both converts to Islam, and we were born and bred...
Converts or reverts?
Whatever you want to call it.
We were
born and raised in the UK, and we're basically... our culture is English or British, whatever you want to call that, in a generic sense. And, you know, for us, that's not a question, yeah? If I want to be a Muslim, no one can force me not to against my will, unless we want to turn into a fascist country. However... Mm. People that come from other countries and cultures, I mean, they should be allowed to practice their culture as long as it doesn't break the law. But you see, when we see Muslims drinking alcohol and sometimes getting rowdy because they drink alcohol and doing bad things, and we try to stop them, but we're told, no, it's a free country. If they want to drink alcohol, if they want to have sex outside marriage, you can't stop them. I say, okay, all we can do is tell them not to, all we can do is condemn them, and we see them driving around trying to pick up girls, and some of them break the law of this country. Now, we can't physically force them and beat them up or whatever because we'll get arrested, all right? And say, oh, look at Muslims, they're imposing their Sharia on everyone. So if we don't impose our Sharia, then we get blamed. And if we do impose our Sharia, we get blamed. So whatever we do, you're damned if you do, and you're damned if you don't. And lastly, when people say, if you look at the world, yeah, around the world, like in Nigeria and all these other countries, why is it that we see it's a lot of Muslims, Muslims are in this violence, always involved in violence, having guns and whatever. But if you look, yeah, okay, let's go around. Palestine, invaded by Zionists. Iraq, invaded by America. Afghanistan, invaded by America. Somali, attacked by American planes and supported forces. Pakistan, drone attacks. Egypt, regime previously supported by America. Tunisia, France actually supplied weapons and even offered police. So what we're seeing is, that's not Muslims walking down number 10 Downing Street with guns and taking over Britain. We're not Muslims going down the White House and taking over. Okay. It's Muslims fighting in their own lands against people going over to their country with guns.
Let's ask Carlos, the BNP, some people are saying that they are finding the embers of intolerance towards the Islamic community. Is it true?
I will tell you the truth. The truth is exactly the opposite. Because we were talking away from cameras about legislation, and we talk about terrorism, and we talk about Islam, and we talk about legislation that has been implemented in this country with the excuse of fighting terrorism that is basically destroying civilian rights. So we have anti-terror laws that perhaps were implemented in Pinochet's Chile or in the Soviet Union, but we have them today here in UK, implemented by politicians who created them to so-called fight terror. So we have they deleted from the law books habeas corpus, which is a right to know what you are accused of.
Sorry, Carlos,
one of the platforms of the BNP is there's one law for everybody in this country. And because there should be one law for everybody in this country, we should get rid of the anti-terror laws and say no more detention without trial.
Okay, thank you, gentlemen, for coming on the show. And you can continue the debate on Twitter at HOTSEAT_Vox. Also join us at facebook.com/HOTSEAT on Vox. Email us, HOTSEAT@voxafrica.com, to leave your comments or suggestions. You can also watch all previous editions of this program on our website, voxafrica.co.uk/HOTSEAT. Next week, another controversial one. Is discrimination more rampant amongst